Ladies and gentlemen, we're about to begin the next session. Please take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage AFA's National Director, East Area, Major Tyler Johnson.
Good morning and thank you. The topic of our next session is Global Operational Perspectives on MDO. To fight and win against peer enemy advanced threats, our airmen must rapidly and reliably integrate and employ MDO capabilities from the heart of our homeland to any battle space anywhere on the planet. If our airmen engaged in aerospace and cyber multi-domain operations can depend upon real-time fused situational awareness, our adversaries will be forced to contend with overwhelming violence and lethality. The Department of Defense should lead the world in situational awareness and fusion capabilities, but it isn't. Even commercial enterprises have more robust capabilities to track assets and operations worldwide. No doubt that in the incredible partnership between our airmen and industry, we can and will develop and field the C2 and decision systems that our warfighters must have. Our panel this morning will address the joint all-domain command and control requirements and systems needed to dominate our enemies across our combatant commands. Our panel includes General Terrence J. O'Shaughnessy, Commander, North American Aerospace Defense Command and U.S. Northern Command. General Charles Q. Brown, Jr., Commander, Pacific Air Forces. And finally, General Jeffrey L. Harrigian, Commander, U.S. Air Forces in Europe. Copies of their bios are in your program. I will now turn over the podium to AFA's President Orville Wright to begin the panel and moderate the Q&A. To submit questions, please go to slido.com and enter the code AWS20 on the website where you can submit your questions. General Wright, over to you, sir.
Well, special thanks to Tyler. As you might see, this group's getting a bit older and the future of our Air Force Association. In fact, you just met one of our board members, Tyler Johnson, is in the hands of great leaders like Tyler. So with that, let's kick it off. General O'Shaughnessy, General Brown, General Regan, thanks so much for being here. Shags.
So first check the technology. Okay, we're good. So let me just start by talking about from the homeland defense perspective. As the commander of NORTHCOM and NORAD, we're focused like a laser on defending our great nations. And I'll start there talking about it from the aspect that it's no longer a sanctuary. And many of us grew up in our entire careers without worrying too much about what happens at home as we've brought the fight all over the world very successfully. But now as we look at our adversaries, we look at their peer adversaries that have the ability to bring the fight back to us at home, it becomes more and more important that we're thinking about war fighting at home as much as we're thinking about it all across the globe. And so from our perspective, as the NDS tells us, we need to make sure that we understand and we take a clear-eyed assessment of our adversaries and we look at our ability to defend ourselves at home. A key part of that is the integration across the globe, and under Chairman Dunford and now Chairman Milley, we've been doing a series of exercises called the Global Integrated Exercises, where we no longer just do an exercise, say, in CQ's domain up in the Pacific or COBRA's domain over in the UCOM in Europe, but we actually look at it from the global aspect. And one of the things we're finding as we do that is regional fights are no longer regional. There is an aspect of a fight in Europe that will very much impact us at home. There's an aspect of a fight in the Asia Pacific that will very much impact us at home. And so that integration between what we're doing away and what we're doing at home becomes even more critical. And so we look at how do we do that and how do we bring it all together from us in the homeland and focus on the homeland. We're starting by looking at what is it that the threats are, and what is it specifically we need to do about them? And what we find is these threats are not single domain threats like we might have had in the past. These are multi-domain threats. And we have, just as we heard from DT Thompson earlier today, we have threats that start in space and they go all the way down to the undersea and everything in between. And so we have to be able to bring our warfighting capability across all of those domains together, even at home, as we posture ourselves to defend the homeland. And so we're looking at developing a capability that has all domain awareness from the undersea all the way through space to include cyber. We're looking at how does that all come together, and that's JADC2, we'll come back to that. And then we have to have defeat mechanisms that can defeat all the threats that we see in all those domains. So the key and core aspect of bringing it together is the JADC2. So NORTHCOM has partnered with the United States Air Force in a series of experiments. And starting with ABS experiment number one that we did in December, one coming up in April, we're trying to put the J in some of the work, the J being the joint, and some of the work that the Air Force has been doing to bring and connect that joint force. And so what we've been doing is trying to see how is it that we can actually bring that force together, not in a deconflicted way, but in a truly integrated fashion. And in order to do so, you have to be able to not only fuse all the information, but then you have to be able to command and control it. And it's not just good enough anymore to just get the situational awareness of where we are today. You then have to take that information, turn it into data that you can actually use to predict the future. And you can have that predictive analysis that can help you with the courses of action that you might have going into the future. And so when we look at this multi-domain operations, we look at it from the homeland defense lens, we see JADC2 as core to that, and that what we need to do is be able to connect that joint force. And I'm really excited about some of the work that the Air Force is doing in order to do that, and I'm really excited about the traction we're getting within the joint force to take JADC2 and bring it into the future, and I look forward to talking more about that. Thank you.
General Brown, thank you.
Hey, good morning. Hey. It's a real pleasure to be here. And I'll just share with you three things I think about three truths as we look at JADC2 and multi-domain operations. The first is we often talk, particularly in the Indo-Pacific, about the first island chain and the threats inside the first island chain. And to build on what Shag just said is when you're looking at multi-domain operations, there are no safe havens. And we're all in some sort, form, or fashion inside the first island chain, depending on the domain you talk about. I also think about the aspect that we cannot buy ourselves out of the threat where we're completely risk-free. And so you got to think about all the domains, where it's air, land, maritime, space, cyber, but also the supporting capabilities. I think a lot about logistics based on the size of our AOR. I think about information and how we push information and how that all kind of aligns into JADC2. But I also believe we have an asymmetric advantage, and that advantage really lies in our allies and partners, because our adversaries do not have the allies and partners that we have. And how we operate with them is important in how we share information. And so all that being said, you know, we're really rethinking three areas, and we can't continue to do things the way we've always done them. One of the areas I'm really thinking about is logistics. I was just in Guam here about 10 days ago, looking at some of our war reserve materiel. And having talked to Arnie Bunch earlier this week, I'm rethinking about how we do that. Right now, I think we look at our WRM, it's like going to Costco. It's all in bulk, sits in a certain location. I think we need to have smaller, tailored packages that we can move around the region, ready to go and integrated into a form and fashion. And also being able to push logistics. I think about Amazon Prime, where you sign up for a subscription. It keeps delivering stuff to you because it knows you're going to use it. You can adjust that subscription. You can cancel it any time if need be, but you adjust that subscription based on the environment. With all the data we have and using AI, I think there's ways for us to be able to do that. And so that's an approach we're thinking about as we move forward. I'm also thinking about how we do command and control. And what I've talked to in various forums with our staff is, you know, with JADC2, the goal is to, you know, connect every sensor to every shooter. Okay, that's a great goal. But right now I want to make sure we can connect the right sensors to the right shooter as we're getting on the path to connecting all. Because we got to be able to fight today, next week, next month, next year, next decade. And it's going to take us a while to get to every sensor, to every shooter, but we got to get the right ones starting out. The other aspect of that is I know our communications will be contested. And I think, and I told my staff, is our primary plan ought to be that we're disconnected and that our communications are going to be vulnerable to attack. Our contingency plan will be that we're all completely connected. And if we're completely connected, we ought to be surprised. And then we got to be suspect that we're being spoofed. And we got to think about it from that aspect of we will not be fully connected. And how we look at advanced management system in the various clouds. And I look at the big cloud that we have data that's coming out of the air operations center and the cloud at the forward edge where we're pushing information. And with enough information far enough in advance that our folks, our airmen, our joint team, with our partners will be able to operate. And so the part of the concept we're working through, we just exercised it in one of our exercises there with INDOPACOM, is how do we do a multi-day air tasking order? And it's not so much that we do a multi-day air tasking order, it's a thought process of what it requires to pull information together so you can lay out information and execution orders several days in advance in case someone is disconnected at the forward edge. They have enough information to continue to operate, not waiting for guidance from me or from our air operations center. And so it's a different thought process that we got to think longer, further in advance, and that's incumbent on me and leaders like myself to think about commander's intent and how we operate and how we position capability around the region. The last is agile combat employment, and I really do appreciate the work that all the MAGCOMs are doing as we work at agile combat employment and how we get lighter, leaner as we move forward. I say right now we are, as an Air Force, we're going glamping. We need to figure out how to go camping. How to get really light and lean and move forward and trust our airmen and empower them to actually go do things that they're trained to do without a lot of oversight and asking for permission from a higher level. And it's a different thought process, and I think we're on the right path, and I appreciate the support that everybody's bringing along. Thanks.
Thanks, sir.
Okay, thanks, Orville. Again, thanks for an opportunity to talk about Joint All Domain Ops and where we're going with that, particularly as it relates to USAFE and AF Africa. Three upfront points from my perspective. Number one, I'd offer we need to continue to work on our understanding of the problem statement and what we're trying to solve as we go forward on this. Number two, I know teams have been working this, but as we look at the roadmap, we've got to develop a roadmap that's executable in terms of delivering capabilities to the warfighters, in particular the joint soldiers, sailors, airmen, marines that are out there going to have to execute this. And then three, I would offer we got to find the right mix between the top-down innovation and the bottom-up innovation and how we mix those together to get the appropriate buy-in moving forward here. So if I go back to the first one of understanding the problem, I thought General Chauncey hit it well in terms of the threats. I think we all recognize we have some commonalities as we look across the globe that drive us to look for capabilities that would help us compete in that environment. There's others, as you look across Europe, Africa, you get into Indo-PACOM and either back in the homeland, that will drive specific capabilities that we're going to need to have moving forward, particularly from not just a capability off a weapon system, but from a C2 perspective. You know, as I look at Africa, that problem is clearly a challenging environment for us to make sure that we've got the sensors to connect to the right nodes as we look across that environment. Importantly, as we look at that operating environment, I think General Brown hit it well. We got to work with NATO. We got to figure out how they will be a key contributor to this broader idea that we're talking about right now and how we incorporate partners, recognizing that we're going to have technical challenges, we're going to have policy challenges. Information sharing, though, will be key to our success if we're going to make this a valid concept moving forward. I think importantly embedded in that problem is fundamentally acknowledging that we're going to have to take on a culture change in how we approach this. Having said that, I think everybody sitting out here has been involved in an all-domain operation. I mean, we do that to a certain extent. Do we do it at the speed and pace that we would like right now? No. But this ought not be looked at as something as we're completely breaking open a whole new idea here that's going to be different to the things that our airmen are doing in the field right now. We will be able to do it with better capabilities and at better speed, but we also need to recognize that mentality is resonant in our force right now. Second, as I highlighted there, as we talk about an executable roadmap, what I've seen, and General Chauncey, your team has been leading on this with the experiments, incredibly important in that it demonstrates the capabilities that are out there. But what I would challenge all of us is we've got to leave behind capabilities that we put in the hands of our airmen. We've got to get the buy-in at that level that this is where we're going and this is how we're going to do it. And we can't expect this to happen in a big bang, and I think everybody acknowledges that, but providing those capabilities in incremental fashion that gets buy-in across the joint force and with our partners will be important to how we move forward on this. And those quick wins and those capabilities that we can get to them, and I would offer in the developmental ops way of thinking, is really where we need to go as we implement this. And then finally, and General Brown and I brought this up back at our command and control summit, it really is getting the right integration and discussion between, I'll use the term, the theater warfighters and those that are generating these innovative ideas that are coming from the top down. We've got to latch that up. If we do that, that will drive great synergy and bring great capabilities at speed to our warfighters. So I think those three things are things we can think about as we go forward here. Look forward to any questions. Thank you.
Thanks. Well, we'll start with the questions. Great start. For the three of you and for your industry partners, you're up close and personal every day with the threats specific to your AORs. Certainly for General Harrigian and Supporter General Walters, the Russians. For General Brown, it's the Chinese and the North Koreans. And certainly for General O'Shaughnessy, it's the Chinese and the Russians from New York to Omaha to LA. So again, for your industry partners, could you just offer a few words, starting with General O'Shaughnessy, on how you see the reality of the threat?
Well, thanks for the question, and I do want to be very clear here. The threats that we face in the homeland are real, and they're advanced. And so we need to work with our industry partners, but we need to do it in different ways. And so what we've done at NORTHCOM and NORAD is instead of going out and saying, we need a widget that does this, this, and this, we're being a much more strategic in our dialogue with industry. And what we're doing is we're bringing them the challenges, and we're saying we face challenges all the way from the undersea activity that we see, from the maritime threats, from the air domain threats that we see, all the way to space and cyber. And we bring that into an overall ecosystem of what we're trying to do to defend our great nation. But as we do so, we're trying to be very open in that we have an overarching architecture of which we're trying to plug into, but we want to just give our challenges to industry, both the defense industry and commercial industry, because there's advantages to both of those. But we do so in a way that allows them to look to see how do they fit into solving some of these challenges. So instead of asking for a specific capability, we gave them insight into the challenges that we faced, and we gave them insight into the broad level understanding of how we're going to solve that. And we've already been amazed by what they've come back with by doing it that way, to see that we can open up maybe the opportunity to see what is it that individual companies can bring. They tend to come back with a much more advanced, a much more thought out ability to bring capability that will ultimately tie in both in the near term and the long term. And as was highlighted by both my partners here, is that there's a time piece of this. And so we can't just be determining things that are going to be great in 10 years. We got to start bringing in that capability soon. And so by having that dialogue with industry, we're finding we're able to bring things left in time, bring capability to bear soon, and then bring more advanced capability that will help solve some of our toughest challenges.
Thanks. General Brown, the threat in your the Indo-PACOM theater.
Well, I think the thing I look at for the threat we face, particularly less so from DPRK, but more so from China, is the fact that there's a lot of activity that goes on kind of below the radar that doesn't necessarily make the press. And so we're in competition all the time. And part of that is we can't wait, 8 to 10 years for something to deliver, just like Shags has described. But it's how do we actually get the ball moving faster? The one area that I think we're when I work with industry and talk is the fact that versus outlining a specific requirement, we're kind of talking about the concept and the vision, and let industry see themselves in that concept and vision, and then the way I think about it, they'll come back to me and go, we have an app for that, we have an approach that can actually solve the challenge you're up against versus me providing a very specific requirement, I get a very specific answer back that may, by the time it delivers, may not meet our requirements because the facts and assumptions all change. And so I think there's good dialogue going forward, and as Shag described, we are, I think, collectively all moving faster, but we still got to pick up the pace.
Terrific.
Yeah, that's great. And clearly, we are very much along in at General Walters level as well with respect to, hey, here's the broader problems that as we see them. I think industry, and we'll hear more about this over the next couple of days, is collectively understanding the vision, but then to General Brown's point, sorting out how they can tailor to our needs based on our environments. And that's where I think it's critically important, and we've been trying to work this with support from General Walters to bring them to the AOR so that they can actually see it and understand it, so that then we can work together to kind of developmentally bring these capabilities that they offer to help solve the problems. I guess the other one that I just feel it's important to bring up, particularly where I live, is while we are clearly zeroed in on Russia, the threats we face in Africa, particularly from a competition perspective, both against the Chinese and Russian, cannot be lost in this discussion. And so while we're looking to compete with them in a myriad of different manners, we're also at the same time focused on force protecting. As we recall, back in January, we lost three Americans at Manda Bay. And those capabilities that we're talking about here, I would offer, will help us in that challenging environment as well.
Great. Thanks. Well, lots of great questions coming from the audience. The system's working. Most of the questions come from someone called Anonymous. However, I have a question from Colonel Melissa Stone, and she was good enough to identify herself, and from Colonel Stone. Sirs, we've heard about work. This is a neat question. We've heard about work in tech and systems needed for MDO. From a cognitive domain perspective, what should we be doing to prepare our human weapon systems?
Well, we're looking for good people at NORTHCOM and NORAD, so.
Germany as well.
So I'm going to have to find Melissa Stone. Hey, what a couple things I'll mention. First off, I think we have to think about who it is that we're bringing onto the teams. I use a quick example at NORTHCOM and NORAD is as we were trying to go down this path of how do we get to JADC2, how do we get to the technology that's available out there, and how do we apply it in different ways, we're trying to transform in kind of a digital transformation within our command. And as we did that, we found when I looked at the folks that we are hiring, the average age of the individuals that we are hiring was 49 years old. So if I bring in the average 49-year-old person in, they're going to think a lot like I think, right? They're going to think a lot like folks that have been around for a long time, have great experience perhaps, but nonetheless, they're not necessarily the different generation that might be able to bring some innovative thought, some different way of looking at our problem set. So I think part of this cognitive aspect is we have to embrace what we have as a society, and we have to be able to bring in different people into our organizations. And so part of that is we look at our digital transformation within the NORTHCOM piece. It really showed us that from an aspect of we have to hire different people, and then we have to train folks. And the example I use is even with myself, where you have to, in the dynamic that we live in today, and it doesn't matter whether you're commercial world or you're in the Department of Defense, you have to continually learn. And so I'm literally on Amazon Web Services taking courses on AWS so that I can keep pace with all of the changing dynamic that we have and things that are available to us. And so we need to be able to bring that to our entire force and encourage and enable that continuous learning that our force needs to have. And then we need to be able to bring in folks that have different experiences than what you might have from a traditional military background.
Terrific. And another not anonymous question of the many anonymous questions, and I probably won't pronounce his name right, but Master Sergeant Kuykendall, this is a good one, I think, for General Harrigian, given the operations in Africa. What does multi-domain operations look like at the tactical unit level? Will the Air Force develop career-specific tactics, techniques, and procedures to integrate into the joint war effort, again, at the tactical level?
So I believe we'll get there over time. You know, at the end of the day, how we integrate these capabilities, because as General Shaughnessy said, there is a cognitive piece of this. I think we have raised ourselves, particularly with the wars we fought for the last 20 years, to expect a lot of Air Force to Air Force inside of our ways of doing business. Whereas we move forward at that tactical level, we got to move to the point where you don't care where it comes from. You're comfortable with that, you trust it, and then you execute your part, if I can call it, of the kill chain to ensure we're achieving the effects that are desired there. And I think as we work through the experiments and our understanding of how this concept actually turns into operations, it'll give us opportunities to build the trust and confidence in this system that will drive potentially some different TTPs and how you accept that information. And because the key will be to all of us have that, and all I think is a bit of an overstatement, but the right people have the right understanding to be able to then execute at speed, which will be required for this enemy.
Yes, sir. And for General Brown, you're in a very joint theater. Certainly, Navy combatant commander, a big area, as you call it. So how bought in do you think, or collaborative are the other services in your joint theater in sort of fulfilling the expectations of the operational objectives of joint all-domain command and control as you work with the other services?
Yeah, I think they're fairly plugged in, but we also all understand the problem as well. And when I look at that is the fact that all of us have long-range weapons capability, and if everybody's, you know, each one of us is either, you know, pulling a lander, hitting a pickle button, activating a strike, it's how we pull all that together. And we understand the challenges associated with that. So we, you know, I think we've acknowledged that there is a problem that we got to actually solve, but it's how we come together as the various services. And that's why I think it's the key part of us as we look at this is what are the right systems and sensors we got to connect now between the different services so we all can buy in and continue to move down the path for, you know, every sensor, every shooter. I think we've all acknowledged it, good dialogue between the components in our various exercises. We also realize there's a lot of work to do to get us where we need to be.
Again, for your industry partners, do you see more and more of a role for industry, actual participation, and increased level of knowledge associated with your exercises?
I do, and part of that is actually, you know, some of the things we're doing with some of the experimentation is for them to be there to actually observe, you know, to watch us in action. Because the more they're able to watch us be able to do things, they'll be able to understand how they may be able to design something or put something in place that actually will help us do what we need to do.
Great.
If I can piggyback on that just for a minute, sure. Both something that both General Brown and General Harrigian mentioned, and that is the participation in the exercises, but also the DevOps mindset. I think we have to embrace that, and it's fairly routine in a commercial world. But as we see that, we see the advancement of their ability to meet our needs and exponentially. If we allow them to do that, we provide them the opportunity to in an environment that is relevant, bring in their team. What they can accomplish in literally days would have taken 6 months or a year to accomplish with that DevOps mindset.
Terrific. This question from the 412th Test Wing. So thanks for being here and joining us at your Air Warfare Symposium. This is probably good for anyone who wants to volunteer, but what do you see the biggest hurdle to executing real-time joint all-domain command and control in a Five Eyes environment?
Our policies. Our ability to share. Yeah. And it's a culture of not so much policy. I think in some cases, and it's not just Five Eye, because all of my partners that I work with are not just a part of the Five Eye consortium, so we actually have to look how broadly we can actually share information with the partners that need to know in order to be able to operate. So it's a little bit of a cultural piece, and there's also a little bit of a policy. And we got to be able to move at the speed that's required with some of our policies ahead of need. So we're ready to go if a contingency or a conflict starts to evolve.
Yeah, sure. Let me just add, since I've been a bit vocal on this, I think there's a policy piece on this. The other part that we spend a lot of time talking about is who actually buys the risk in this scenario. If you're protecting sources and methods, and you just want to get it to the right people, then we need to be thoughtful about who buys the risk and who we delegate that authority to manage it, whether it be at the tactical level, the operational level. You know, unfortunately, it appears to me that it takes a war or a critical event to happen before we say, okay, I guess we should have done that. Yeah. And so we know that now. We've talked about it time and time again. Now's the time to fix it in competition and work through that and allow commanders to be commanders and make smart risk decisions based on the environment they're operating in.
Yes, sir. Again, back to General Brown, a very specific question. When will PACAF start maximizing use of the surface and sea domain for storage and distribution, small vessels and not large vessels?
That's a good question. I don't know that, you know, it's part of working the joint requirements associated with this. So, I mean, there's a lot of good discussion, and I think there's a lot of things in when we talk about innovation to be able to use the other domains about how you move and support logistics. You know, one of the things we're talking about within INDOPACOM is, do we have a logistics component commander? Just based on the size of the region and all the things that are going to have to move, should someone be sitting in charge of completely logistics? And I think there's an aspect of that will help PACAF, PAC fleet, and the other components think through how we're going to use the limited resources to move capability. But I also believe we need to pre-position capability so you're not waiting to try to execute, you know, a tip fid, so we can move at the pace we're going to need to move forward. So I think there's plenty of opportunities there. And the other aspect, the last thing I'd actually add to that for all of us is, if we're talking about joint domain all JADC2, we also need to think about how we solve problems jointly versus trying to just use air capabilities to support logistics. And so that means leaning on maritime or Army watercraft, for example, or other opportunities that we need to start taking advantage of.
Great. Back to General Shaughnessy. As you look at the cyber threat to the homeland, are you collaborating closely with CyberCom day-to-day, obviously between NORTHCOM and CyberCom, with the situational awareness you need to collaborate to defend the homeland against a range of cyber threats from all over the world?
Yeah, clearly there are significant threats to the homeland from in the cyber domain. And I would say, clearly, we are partnering very closely and do on a literally daily basis with Cyber Command. But I would also say it's bigger than that. And as you look at it from our national critical infrastructure, not just our DOD critical infrastructure, we're also partnered with the Department of Homeland Security. And as they've advanced their capability, and they stood up CISA, the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, that is specifically tasked with defending our critical infrastructure from the cyber domain across our nation, they are also incredibly collaborative and great partners. But what we find is we all have a little bit different role within that, and how do we define that, and how do we further advance that, and continuing to look at the threats. And I'll just use an example of the elections in 2018. NORTHCOM and CyberCom participated in some of the election security. One of the ways that we were able to do that was taking full advantage of our Guard. Our National Guard are great partners in all the missions we do within NORTHCOM, but we also found they're great partners in the cybersecurity as well, because if you think about our electoral system, it's really run by the states and then brought up to the federal piece of that. And so we applied the same model that we have in a DISCA, the Defense Support Civil Authorities, that we do for, say, a hurricane, and we applied that to cybersecurity. And so we, NORTHCOM, don't have specific cyber capability or expertise necessarily beyond what any combatant command does. But what we do is we're able to take Paul Nakasone's team and funnel it through NORTHCOM and then be able to apply that in a DISCA-type model, federal capability down to a state level. We had Paul Nakasone came in, the Department of Homeland Security came in, and all of the tags came into a conference that we held twice now within NORTHCOM in preparation for these elections to coordinate the level, to share intel, to bring it up to the highest classification level so the tags at the state level have the SA, and then they are able to put in sensors, and they know that they can set up the Red Star cluster when they need help at the state level from the federal, whether that be from DHS or Cyber Command or NORTHCOM. We now have the forums of which to do that. But this is a threat going in the future, not just for election security, but for our critical infrastructure that will remain incredibly important.
Yeah, sir. Hey, if I could just a little shout out for our 16th Air Force brothers and sisters. Their alignment with General Walter's priorities inside of UCOM to get after his priorities along that cyber line of effort has really, in very short period of time, proved huge dividends for the collective force. And not only understanding and clarifying where we needed help or where they were perceiving threats from an I&W perspective, but then offering solutions that were quickly implemented because they had the right authorities. And I would offer to you over time the power of that ISR cyber connection and the authorities they have are very helpful to the combatant commands, and one I would think as time moves on will be one shared across the force.
Great. General Brown, back to you. You got some specific examples that could be, in fact, used as a template for industry where you've had very successful interaction in your theater with industry, including innovation opportunities or just solving hard problems, command and control problems or other problems.
Well, one of the things is we have a science and technology information exchange, and we had it here back in November. And it's a great opportunity for us to bring industry in and kind of walk them through the concepts that we're working on. And again, it's kind of how we just, we have a capabilities list, a capability gaps list. But I told my team, hey, we got to talk just because otherwise, if we just give them the gaps list, they'll solve that gap, but it may not solve the problem. And so the dialogue that we were able to have with them to talk through how we would work our O plan, aspects of the O plan, aspects of our strategy, has been very helpful with the industry. Because I kind of see it coming back as I talk to industry. Some of the things we're talking about, they're providing solutions and opportunities. You know, our challenge is how do we get that into our system to actually be able to fund some of those things to move the ball forward.
Yes, sir. A lot of questions from the audience on the Arctic, implications for melting ice cap and what's going on in the Arctic. Obviously, Russians very active in that area. So take it away. Whoever would want to start with the Arctic, it's certainly of interest to our audience.
Yeah, I'll start. And the way we look at the Arctic is it's an avenue of approach to the homeland. And so we used to look at that as a buffer zone, much like the oceans used to be moats. And now it's an attack vector. And we clearly see Russia advancing their capability and capacity to operate there. Now, some of that makes sense based on a large percentage of their GDP is based on the economics of what they garner from the Arctic. But some of the development clearly appears to be going well beyond that. And so one of the roles that we have is within our unified command plan for NORTHCOM is we are the Arctic advocate. So we are, despite the, we share with both PACOM and UCOM, the Arctic battle space, if you will, we are designated as one advocating for our capability and capacity. And so one of the things that we're really focused on is how do we make sure the force is able to operate in that very difficult environment? And I'll bring two things to mind here. One is you can deploy a force, say to the Middle East, to other areas all over the globe that hasn't necessarily been there before. And they can be quite effective. But you can't do that in the Arctic. If you have not trained, if you don't have the right kit, you don't have the right gear, you will not be able to operate effectively in the Arctic. And so more and more it's about how do we get the services to include our great United States Air Force to increase the exposure that we give our airmen to the Arctic conditions. And we have a great range in the Jay Park range up in Alaska that gives great opportunity to do that. So continuing to expose our force there, develop capability to operate in the Arctic is critically important. And the second piece of it is we need to be able to communicate in the Arctic. And one of the things we find is leveraging with commercial industry is gonna help us advance our capability to get that communication there and partnering with folks that have similar challenges, for example, the oil industry, some of the Alaska Federation of Natives and the indigenous people have similar challenges of lack of that communication. So how can we partner with them to make a business case to get the commercial world to provide those services? And so we're working with things like Starlink, OneWeb are great examples where if you could get communication at the level that you have in your home and broadband connectivity throughout the Arctic, that would completely change our ability to operate there where some of our satellites don't have the ability to fully connect there. And those endeavors that we're doing with those companies, I think are gonna change the way that we will be able to operate in the Arctic to connect the force once they're trained and able to operate there in a much more robust fashion.
Terrific, yeah, sure.
What I'd add is, we do kind of pay attention to the Arctic, but I also pay to the attention to the Antarctic because what happens in the Arctic is a precursor to what could potentially occur in the Antarctic. And the Antarctic Treaty is up for review in 2048. There is actually great power competition on the ice down there. with the Russians and the PRC. And I think we just got to be paying attention to it so it doesn't get, you know, to go down a path where you're not doing doing more than research. And that's an aspect we're paying attention to and learning some things of what's going on in the Arctic when you start talking about capabilities, because you'll have the same capabilities down at the South Pole.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'll just add, as General Shaughnessy said, we've had opportunities with our partners to leverage the Arctic also as an opportunity for ourselves to create a dilemma for the Russians. Recognizing what we've been able to do with bomber task force support from some of the nations that clearly have interests up there, we've been able to leverage that to learn about some of the challenges that we have up there when it comes to communications, to being able to operate, but also at the same time provide us the insight to how we could better compete as global integrators in the Arctic. Now, we've got work to do, but I think just the connective tissue we have to have across the combatant commands to be able to do that is frankly something the Russians recognize we're doing, and it's going to drive them to either dedicate resources to it or at least think through how they would manage to protect that should we use that as an access for entry into Russia.
Okay, last round of questions, and again, thanks to Major Ballantyne. You all have gotten into this somewhat already, but what, given the benefits, potential benefits of multi-domain operations and joint all-domain command control to fuse and integrate those operations in a common operational picture, what are some of the challenges, even threats, that you see? We've talked about the electronic threat. You've addressed somewhat command and control at too high a level that would impact the ability of our forces to operate. So let's just wind up with MDO, the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Well, I'll start and just look at the threats that we're faced to the homeland. We used to be able to look at these very stovepipe, right? You look at from ballistic missile defense, you have a system that's designed to give you that initial warning and then be able to actually defeat threats from, say, a rogue nation like North Korea. You have the ability to operate in against air threats and, say, Russia long-range aviation. But now as we look at the advanced threats where we have it literally from the undersea threats that we face, the maritime threats that we face, the air domain threats we face, and the space threats, as D.T. Thompson talked about, to include, as well as the cyber, we can't approach those in a stovepipe manner. We have to look at this from the overall multi-domain aspect of that and all-domain aspect of that if we're going to be able to put an affordable system forward. So we are looking at this from the ground up to build this, what we're calling the strategic homeland integrated ecosystem for layered defense that is truly multi-domain from the start. And that way you can plug in different capabilities, but they contribute across multiple domains. That going forward, I think given the advanced nature of the threats, given, for example, hypersonics that you can no longer take a ballistic missile that you can just have a radar on for a short time, but because it's ballistic, you now know where it's going. You now need to maintain custody of that threat the entire time. Those advanced threats drive us to this multi-domain look at this. And so I think all the things we build going in the future need to plug into the broader multi-domain capability if we're going to be able to afford all the systems to put them together.
Joe Brown.
Hey, I think the good part is that there's good dialogue when you look at JADC2, multi-domain operations, and it forces us to be more joint and coalition focused. So that's the good part. I think some of the challenge, I wouldn't call it bad or ugly, but the I think some of the challenges we're going to have in the future is how we're, with all that information, connecting every sensor to every shooter, how we divvy that up across the joint force so we can put the effects, both kinetic and non-kinetic, in place to make things happen. And so we don't all show up at the same place, all trying to put capability on on the threat, or we leave a gap. And those are my concerns. And then the last piece is just the concern I have is our ability to actually trust each other to be able to do things and allow at the lower level or our joint or coalition partner to take action so we can move at the speed that's required. If we got to check the checker, it's going to take us a while to get to where we need to be. So we got to be able to delegate down to our lower level and trust them to do their job.
And to wind up, General Regan, thank you so much.
So here's my analogy on this. You know, everybody's been out in the joint command. You got the planners, the J5 comes up with a great idea, right? They lay this idea out, and then they look at you in the three in ops and go, get after it. And you're like, whoa, hey, This is not that easy. That's right, fam man. You're the guy in the five giving it to the three. And so now we got to turn PowerPoint into action. And like each one of us said, we got to do things now to set us up to win the fight that I believe incrementally we can build these capabilities with the right people cognitively, with the right capabilities, with the support from our partners, from the defense industry to get where we need to go. But we got to make sure we keep thinking all the way through this to make sure we're solving the right problem. I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Well, you all have been awesome. Thank you so very much. Now, a couple of important points for me to make. First of all, thank you. Dr. Roper started out this whole crazy socks thing, so we've got the new version. So this is our donation to your sock drawer. We can't thank you enough. There's good news and bad news as we continue to grow here at the Air Force Association. This is a bigger room than it was last year. We have growing pains, as you all experienced this morning, and it's all on me. So if you want to blame somebody, blame Orville. We had to go to an off-site, an off-dislocated parking location because essentially of the size of how we've grown and competing with another conference here. We just got some notification. If you didn't go to the designated off-site public parking area and you parked at Publix across the street, we're trying to fend off Publix right now because they want to tow you. Obviously, they're trying to make a living, and we've overwhelmed the Publix parking lot. So please take some time and go out there and move your car. On the way to do that, however, please go by and see our new helicopter, which is going to be there until 12:30. And again, thank you all so much for your patience as our Air Force continues to be stronger. Our airmen, it's my job to say this, and I believe it, our airmen continue to be the most lethal arm of a more capable and lethal joint force. And we've got some great airmen up here leading that force. Thank you to all of our many attendees, and thanks especially for being members of our Air Force Association. Go see the helicopter and move your car.